In 1945, 58-year-old Ohio-born house painter Albert Stevens checked into the University of California San Francisco Hospital complaining of stomach pain. The doctors present at UCSF would tell Stevens that he had terminal stomach cancer, giving him approximately 6 months to live. Days later, he would return for treatment. Scientists injected Stevens with a mixture consisting of 0.2 micrograms of plutonium-238 and 0.7 micrograms of plutonium-239, though they did not tell him what was in the injection. One of the scientists remarked later that this was many times the so-called lethal textbook dose of plutonium. In the time following the injection, Stevens returned and had a surgery and biopsy performed. The scientists had, without Stevens' knowledge, injected him with so much plutonium that not only could it cause him to develop cancer, but had a half-life such that it would continue to release ionizing radiation that would stay in his body for the rest of his life. Stevens would even provide the scientists responsible with urine and stool samples for years following the event, unknowingly assisting the scientists further with their research. All of this was done without Stevens' consent or knowledge, and in the words of Acting Chief of Radiology Earl Miller, he was chosen because he was doomed to die. In the 20 years following the injection, Stevens' body accumulated approximately 64 sieverts, or about 3 sieverts per year. To put this into perspective, each year his body received around 60 times the yearly maximum allowed by radiation workers in the United States. On January 9, 1966, Albert Stevens would pass away, not from cancer, but from heart disease. During the days of the Manhattan Project, scientists experimented with plutonium injections on 18 people aged 4 to 69. Stevens was neither the first involuntary human radiation experiment nor the last, but a 1975 study revealed that he had the highest accumulated lifetime dose of radiation in history. Stevens was recognized posthumously for his contributions to science without informed consent. If this content interests you, consider liking and subscribing. This helps other like-minded individuals find this content and have informed conversation in the comments. Now back to the next stories. On September 30th, 1999, at a fuel reprocessing facility in the Japanese village of Tokai, 75 kilometers northeast of Tokyo, a criticality accident would take place. Three technicians, Hisashi Ouchi, Masato Shinohara, and Yutaka Yokokawa, would be exposed to 17, 10, and 3 sieverts respectively. Referencing the number mentioned earlier in this video, 3 sieverts alone is over 60 times the maximum recommended exposure over a year, let alone during a single event. While Yokokawa would survive his exposure, Ouchi would endure 83 days of suffering as his skin dissolved over his body, his internal organs shut down, and his immune system failed. At first, there was no abnormality in either Ouchi nor Shinohara, but in less than a day, they began deteriorating rapidly. Ouchi's skin began appearing dark, red, and swollen. The radiation had obliterated his lymphatic cells, white blood cells critical to the body's immune system. In 1 week, his white blood cell count was almost non-existent. Infection was a severe risk at this point, but thanks to a stem cell transplant from his sister, doctors were hopeful his white blood cell count could be raised. This procedure was revolutionary at the time, and it was faster than a bone marrow transplant, a procedure that many of the Chernobyl liquidators would undergo. This hope would not last long, though, as the incredible amount of radiation in his body mutated the transplanted cells, which caused an autoimmune response that contributed to his worsening condition. As he continued to deteriorate, doctors would question the ethics of keeping him alive, as his body became increasingly resistant to treatment. For the time being, he was lucid, able to talk to his wife and the hospital staff, but he seemed oblivious. He was unaware of the true extent of the damage done to his body. As time went on, Ouchi became increasingly angry. He would protest treatment, telling doctors to stop, that he wanted to go home. His family, however, urged the doctors to do all they could. They wanted Ouchi to see the new millennium on January 1st, 2000. This would never happen. The particulars of this topic have been covered extensively in documentaries and other YouTube videos, and if you want to learn exactly what happened to his body during those last 83 days, I will link to a couple videos on the subject, but be advised, this subject is not for the faint of heart. The radiation decimated his chromosomes, fundamentally altered his DNA such that his body did not know how to produce white blood cells, absorb nutrients, or regenerate skin. Proceed carefully. Over the course of his hospitalization, due to his family's protests, Hisashi Ouchi would be resuscitated from cardiac arrest multiple times, each time severely damaging his brain. On the 81st day, his family agreed with doctors that should he go into cardiac arrest again, he would not be revived. 2 days later, on December 21st, 1999, Hisashi Ouchi finally passed away. As for Masato Shinohara, the other worker, his time in hospital was not as closely documented. He endured many of the same treatments, stem cell transplants, skin grafts, and radical cancer treatments, but ultimately passed away from multiple organ failure after 211 days in hospital. In December of 2001, three men from the village of Lia, Georgia, had driven about 50 kilometers into a forest to collect firewood, 320 kilometers from the Georgian capital of Tbilisi. In the snowy forest, which overlooked Anguri Dam, they discovered two cylindrical objects on the ground as the sun set. The snow around the objects had melted and the area was clearly steaming with heat. The men, known only as DN, MG, and MB, examined the objects from a distance before MB picked one up. The object was very hot and he dropped it immediately. As the sun had already set, and seeing that these objects may keep them warm for the night, they decided to stay overnight in the forest and set up camp. MB used a strong wire to hook onto the object and carry it to an outcrop of rock where they set up a small fire, keeping the unknown objects near them as a source of heat. They had a meal and drank some vodka. Soon after, the three men became nauseous and dizzy and soon began vomiting. Unaware that these are the first telltale signs of acute radiation sickness, also known as ARS. Finding it difficult to sleep, they used the objects for warmth, vomiting throughout the night. The following morning, having gotten little sleep and extremely fatigued, they loaded their truck with half the wood they had intended to collect. Carrying the unknown objects on their back, they also loaded them in the truck and returned to Lia by the next evening. The next morning, MG visited a local doctor who assumed his vomiting, dizziness, and nausea were the result of alcohol. The doctor gave him a shot and the symptoms seemed to disappear. In the following days, family members of the three men noticed the skin on their backs had begun to peel away, not unlike a bad sunburn. A week after they had found the cylindrical objects, the skin of all three men had redness, swelling, and painful blisters, another symptom of ARS. All three were hospitalized 3 weeks later on December 22nd, where they were officially diagnosed with acute radiation sickness. MB received treatment and was discharged on 23rd January 2002. The other two men were in much more serious condition. DN was moved to a hospital in Moscow, whereas MG was sent to a military hospital in Paris. MG's treatment lasted for over a year as he required extensive skin grafts on his back. He was eventually discharged on March 18, 2003 after a month of treatment. However, DN was not so lucky. His injuries persisted, having received the highest dose of radiation to his skin, heart, and internal organs. After intensive care, which included many rounds of antibiotics, surgeries, and attempted skin grafts, the radiation ulcer on his back would not heal. Past drug use had weakened his health, and his condition was worsened when he contracted tuberculosis. He eventually developed sepsis, formerly known as blood poisoning, and died of heart failure on May 13, 2004, 893 days after the three men discovered the mysterious cylinders. As it turned out, the objects the men had found were the cores of radioisotope thermoelectric generators, or RTGs, which are commonly used in spaceflight. Heat given off by decaying radioactive material, strontium-90 in this case, can be converted into electricity and used to power spacecraft for many years. In this case, the generators had been deployed to power radio relays between the Anguri and Hudoni dams, as the remote location made traditional electricity access difficult. When examined, the exposed strontium-90 cores were found to emit 4.6 sieverts per hour. In total, 8 generators were used, with 6 of them being found and disposed of properly, and the remaining 2 found by the three men in 2001. Thank you for watching this far. If this kind of thing interests you, I have several other videos that also might. Be sure to check out my channel for more videos and playlists, and if you'd like more of this kind of content, like, subscribe, and share with people you'd think would appreciate it. Thank you.